मैं कर देता हूँ स्टार्ट।
अब तो तेरे को और
गोपाल,
गोपाल
यस
अब तो
सर
विवेक जो बोल रहा
नाउ
है, विवेक जो बोल रहा है तेरे को और भी कौसा सोना पड़ेगा, ठीक से देख,
बिल्कुल
डबल चेक कर देकर।
बिल्कुल सर।
अभी
कैन यू सी नाउ सर?
आ रहा है। हाँ
अभी आ गया, चल
ओके सर। चलो स्टार्ट, शैल आई स्टार्ट सर नाउ?
यस सर, यू
चालू
कैन
करो,
स्टार्ट।
चालू करो, टाइम हो गया, टाइम हो गया, चालू करो, ऑलरेडी वी आर 2 मिनट्स अहेड।
ओके, गुड इवनिंग टीचर्स एंड फ्रेंड्स।
म्यूट एवरीबॉडी, म्यूट म्यूट एवरीबॉडी, म्यूट कर दो जयंत, म्यूट कर दो सबको।
आप बताइए सर कब स्टॉप।
करो तुम, मैंने कर दिया सबको म्यूट। गोपाल अनम्यूट।
यस सर, कैन यू हियर मी नाउ?
यस।
ओके, गुड इवनिंग टीचर्स एंड फ्रेंड्स। टुडे वी विल गो इनटू बेसिक्स ऑफ एक्सरेज इन ऑर्थोपेडिक्स। ओरिजिनल इट इज द आर्ट ऑफ कंसीलिंग योर सोर्स, तो दैट इज माय डिक्लेरेशन। इन फैक्ट एक्सरेज इन ऑर्थोपेडिक्स, टुडे वी विल कंप्लीट द हिस्टोरिकल पर्सपेक्टिव एंड रेडिएशन सेफ्टी इन शॉर्ट, introduction to x-ray use in orthopedics again in short, and in detail focal bony lesion evaluation, that is bone tumors. After basics of these bone tumors, I will shortly discuss with metabolic bone diseases, and then I will start with malignant and benign bone tumors. So on 8 December 1895, German physics professor Wilhelm Conrad Roentgen discovered the X-ray while performing some experiments with Leonard and Crookes tubes. So when Roentgen held a piece of lead in front of the electron discharge tube, it blocked the rays, but he was surprised to see his own flesh glowing around his bones on the fluorescent screen behind his hand. So he placed a photographic film between his hand and screen and captured world's first X-ray image, what we are seeing on the screen. 6 months after that, to locate bullets in wounded soldiers, medical field, that is battlefield physicians, started use of X-rays precisely in June 1896. So X-rays penetrate different objects more or less according to their density, and this property is used in medicine. Calcium in bones makes bones denser, so bones absorb more radiation and they appear more white on X-rays. So X-rays are harmful, having harmful effects, and to protect ourselves, shielding is very important. And for that, lead metal was found to be protective against X-rays and gamma rays. So pure lead cannot being brittle cannot be used for shielding. So lead composite came in picture, and when lead composite used, weight of the lead apron was also reduced by 25%, as lead is being very heavy. 1 square centimeter corresponds almost 11.3 grams. And during this journey, tin, antimony, tungsten, and bismuth like other metals were also discovered to be radio resistant, X-ray resistant. So various forms of sealed material available as of now, like aprons, waist kits, thyroid shields, and various other sorts of shielding material is there. Radiation shielding being very important part as far as our own safety, medical safety is concerned. Nowadays, a principle called ALARA, A-L-A-R-A, is used because minimization of radiation doses and limiting release of radioactive materials into the environment is very essential, and so the principal acronym named ALARA is as low as reasonably achieved is followed worldwide. So how these 7 principles are there, of which 3 principles, they reduce external radiation exposure by time, means reducing the exposure time, increasing the distance, doubling the distance from your body and radiation source, divides exposure 4 times, means it reduces exposure by 4 times, and also use of various seals. Through food, drink, or contaminated environment, there is chance of internal radiation hazards and good hygiene, control of contamination, airborne hazards, and proper use of personal protective equipments. They are very important, and this includes 7 principles of ALARA. So now, the methods as an orthopedic surgeons means the investigations, which radiological investigations we are using nowadays, they are the plain X-rays, ultrasound, CT scan, MRI, nuclear imaging, CT or MRI angiography, and PET scan, of which our focus today is plain radiographs or X-rays. What is the need for us? Because we as ortho surgeons cannot function without radiographs. Radiographers and interpreters is actually our role in majority of our initial phases of practice. And radiologists, they have shifted their focus towards more challenging branches like CT, MRI, PET scan, and other modalities. But countries like India, where plain radiological examination stands the major part of our practice. So radiographic examination is an important dimension of our care and needs to be performed well to avoid false negative, which may affect patient's care adversely. So which study to be asked for, which X-ray view to be taken for, and it should be executed correctly, that is very important to reach to the conclusion or diagnosis. And for that, we can say rule of two is very essential in orthopedics. So what is this rule of two? Two views, orthogonal or 90 degrees with each other, like anteroposterior or lateral view, or we can say coronal or sagittal views. Two joints, one joint above and one joint below. Two times before close reduction and after close reduction, or after initial plaster application and after some time. Two injuries means first injury is detected, and to rule out injury at some other part, not in continuity of that particular part again, and two sides. In case of certain injuries in children, to compare, we need to have these two sides. So, two views. What is the importance? Don't go by the face value. You may be wrong. You may miss the boat. So, if I will see this X-ray in anteroposterior view, I may think of going for conservative management, but wait. This is the importance of two views. And if these two views are there, then our management remains what we are seeing with plating. Again, two joints, one above and one below. If you will see this X-ray, our diagnosis remains comminuted femoral shaft fracture, and we may think of interlocking with nail. But yes, rule of two. Here, I just expose the proximal joint, and in this injury, even patella also can be injured. So always go for one joint above and one joint below. Why two times? Watch here. This is a subtle injury. And when patient comes back after 2 weeks, this is the displacement. So continuous monitoring and repeated X-rays, they are essential. So plain radiograph or X-rays remain single most important investigations for our diagnosis, requires systematic, step-by-step, meticulous observation for reading X-rays, and always hold and view X-ray film in anatomical position. So how to read these X-rays? You can go either outside in or inside out. Means either you start from the medullary canal and diaphysis, proximal distal end, then joint, then come to the soft tissues, means inside out, or you can go from soft tissues to the bones and to the joints. You can also see while reading the adequacy of exposure, whether it is there, alignment is there, then bone, cartilage, disc, and soft tissue involvement. These are various methods, but aim remains the same. We have to systematically read the X-rays. So now our basics of bone tumor, if I have to evaluate in radiological examination, then focal lesion diagnosis, there is a 10 points method I feel is very useful for us. So age, site of the lesion, pattern of bone destruction, margin of the lesion, then cortical response, matrix mineralization, periosteal reaction, soft tissue reaction, number of lesions, and touch me not type lesions. So before actually starting with each point of this 10 one by one, these two, three slides, I feel they are foundation stone or basics to understand the understanding and differentiating between benign versus aggressive lesions. So to decide whether it is benign or malignant, five important points one should always think of, that is rate of progression, whether it is slow or rapid, zone of transition, whether it is narrow or wide, cortical destruction, whether it is there, cortex is intact or destruction is there, and periosteal reaction, whether it is solid or interrupted, and soft tissue component, that is invasion of tumor, whether it is affecting, invading in the soft tissue or not. And once these 5 points we have gone through, then decide about the matrix or mineralization in that lesion, whether this matrix is chondroid or osteoid type. And after this, differentiate these three important factors, that is age of the patient, whether it is less than 30 years or more, affected part is whether axial or appendicular skeleton, and location within the bone. So here we start with the first point, that is age of the patient and why it is important. Slide is self-explanatory. These 11 representative tumors I have taken, and the duration, which decade. So in the first decade, almost first four points on our left side, that is five lesions, metastatic neurofibroblastoma, usually less than 2 years of age is most common. Then benign tumors like simple bone cyst or aneurysmal bone cyst or fibrous cortical dysplasia or Ewing sarcoma, they are common in first decade, but Ewing's is in first two decades, osteosarcoma mainly in second decade. So this slide clearly explains importance of the age. Now location is also very important. If we just take the example of spine, that is vertebra, the vertebral body or the marrow lesions part like myeloma, lymphoma, Ewing sarcoma, hemangioma or eosinophilic granuloma, more common in vertebral body area. Sir, is there any instruction to me? The posterior elements like
going on well, please.
Right, continue. Sir. There is disturbance, so I ask, sir. Thank you. Sir, in posterior elements, osteoid, osteoma, osteoblastoma, meds, osteochondroma, and aneurysmal bone cyst, they are the common locations. Again, which location of the bone, whether it is epiphysis, metaphysis, or diaphysis, and import, these are three important slides actually. In epiphysis, one should, as an exam going student, remember that it is giant cell tumor or chondroblastoma. In metaphysis, then ABC, SBC, CMF, that's focal cortical dysplasia, fibrous cortical dysplasia, osteoid osteoma, and osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, or fibrosarcoma. They are basically in metaphyseal region most commonly seen. And in diaphysis, Ewing sarcoma, enchondroma, adamantum myeloma, they are the commonly seen. Again, central and peripheral lesions, if you will think, then simple bone cyst and enchondroma are the central lesions, whereas giant cell tumor, non-ossifying fibroma, and fibrous cortical defect, aneurysmal bone cyst, chondromyxoid fibroma, they are the peripheral lesions. So now, lesion, chondroblastoma, just keep saying infection, these are the sites, ABC, SBC, osteochondroma, means metaphyseal lesion, osteosarcoma, enchondroma, osteoid osteoma. GCT, and finally METS. So pattern of third point is bone destruction. Could be geographical, moth-eaten, or permeative. From geographical to permeative, there is a aggressiveness from benign to malignant transformation trend is there. So geographical region, Ludlow's classification again classifies the geographical lesion in three forms. That is, a well-defined lesion with sclerotic margin is 1A. Like here, well-defined lucency with sclerotic rim and intraosseous lipoma within the sclerotic rim. Means there is a lytic region with the sclerotic margin, that is 1A, and can be seen in fibrous dysplasia or bone cyst or other conditions. Type 2, this sclerotic margin part is missing here. Well-defined, lucent, but without sclerotic margin like multiple myeloma or giant cell tumor. And ill-defined, they are the aggressive. Lytic lesion with Codman's triangle, periosteal interruption, and tumor-induced new bone formation. They are there, and the likely pathologies could be osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, or fibrosarcoma. Now, important part, we always say moth-eaten. What we understand by moth-eaten pattern? So this moth eats the leaves, and whatever these holes are appear, we are seeing on the leaf, similar type of pattern we find on the bones, and areas of destruction with ragged borders, we describe it, implies more rapid growth and probably malignant lesion. So this is the, if the leaf is completely destroyed or if the lesion is aggressively progressed, the bone may look like this, otherwise the leaf is looking. So multiple between 2 to 5 millimeter size confluent lytic lesions with wide zone of transition and indistinct end osteal scallopings. So differential diagnosis, all sorts of this osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, fibrosarcoma, they are aggressive lesions we should think of in the differential diagnosis. Ewing sarcoma, and never forget a benign chronic osteomyelitis lesion. Patterns of bone destruction, permeative type. Here, multiple whole uniform lucencies less than 1 millimeter in size, ill-defined, rapidly destructive lesions with exuberant cortical tunneling is there. And differentials, we can think of Ewing sarcoma, reticulum cell sarcoma, leukemia, or metastasis. Next important point is margin of the lesion. So benign lesions usually have sharply or well-defined sclerotic margins with slow rate of growth and narrow zone of transitions, as against malignant lesions where ill-defined margins, aggressive appearance, faster growth rate, and wide zone of transition, they are important. In cortical response, expanded scallop or eroded cortical response, we are supposed to examine. That is, destruction of cortex by lytic or sclerotic process, what we are seeing here, and endosteal scalloping, another type, is thinning of the cortex by intraosseous process, is we can describe it. So there are basically three types of responses: trabeculations type of response, or endosteal scalloping, or saucerization type of response. Then matrix. What is matrix? A cellular intercellular substance formed by the mesenchymal cells is called matrix. And the various types of matrix, clear, ground glass, or calcified type, INDAC also, whether it is a cartilaginous or osseous type of calcified matrix, they are the important one. And as we have seen here, a cellular intercellular substance formed by mesenchymal cells. So this osteoblast cell forms osteoid type of matrix, chondroblasts form chondroid type, and fibroblasts form fibrous matrix and collagenous matrix. So clear matrix refers to a lesion which are clear or mostly clear and radiolucent lesions with few undestroyed trabeculae considered to have clear matrix. Osseous matrix, interlacing radiodense struts in a laminar fashion, like in myositis ossificans or high-grade osteosarcoma. This is solid cloud-like or ivory-like pattern of the sort of matrix, this type of matrix explained above, and actual radiographic appearance, I have described it down. Then cartilaginous sort of matrix, stipple type or flocculent type of ring and arc type that we are looking into. So we can see here enchondroma or chondrosarcoma. Again, here endosteal scalloping is there. So basically dense ivory cloud-like calcification whenever is there, we think of osteoid pattern of mineralization. And arc and ring-like calcification, usually we think of chondroid type of pattern, and accordingly we will think of differentials while explaining. So periosteal reaction is another and very important point. The Periosteum is highly vascular, outer fibrous and inner cambium layer tissue. Their serpes fibers, they are perpendicularly oriented to collagen fibers that attach periosteum to underlying surface. And this periosteal reaction can be of two types. Periosteum is elevated by adding new bone, or it is resorbed by, like in hyperparathyroidism. Students, please unmute. It is disturbing. A periosteal reaction usually is observable in 10 to 21 days. It indicates biological activity. More interrupted or complex pattern suggests more aggressive lesion. So periosteal reaction, again, for our understanding, there are three types: continuous type of reaction, speculated or interrupted. And to have good differentials, again, continuous is of five types: shell type of continuous, or solid type as in osteodystoma, undulating like varicosities, single lamellar or Onion skin. So what is shell type? It reflects bone remodeling. Endosteal resorption is more than periosteal new bone formation, and hence the outcome. So smooth cell type seen in giant cell tumor, lobulated or rigid cell type is seen in the non-ossifying fibroma. The solid type of periosteal reaction, as I said, is seen in the osteodystoma, where ossification of multiple layers of periosteal bone in response to slow growing lesion is seen, and on X-ray, cortical thickening or hyperostosis is seen. The solid variants could be seen in varicosities or chronic lymphedema or chronic osteomyelitis. Single rim of bone separated from underlying cortex by 1 to 2 millimeter, caused by dilated blood vessels, blood pus or tumor cells, and seen in healing or stress fracture, osteomyelitis or eosinophilic granuloma. The lamellated or onion skin reaction is multiple parallel lamellae are seen. Now, next type is the speculated type. Hair on end or sunburst or velvet, these are the three types. Aggressive lesions, these reactions suggest us. The spicules are largest at the epicenter of the lesion. Spicules can be parallel, like hair on end appearance, and divergent when it is sunburst appearance, or velvet type when they are parallel. Like calvarium thalassemia or chronic anemia, these are the examples where we can see the speculated type of periosteal reaction. The interrupted type is the last type of this reaction, is Codman triangle. We can see there buttress or underlying cortex is intact, and truncated type of lamellae. This is another type of interrupted. Again, it suggests aggressive lesion. Codman triangle means seen as two sides of triangle at the demarcated ends of the lesion. Buttress means solid reactive bone at the lateral extraosseous margins, seen in relatively slow growing lesions. Cortex beneath the buttress is intact. And truncated lamina again suggests aggressive tumor or virulent infection. Complex periosteal reaction is another type which where there is a combination of above these three types. Now, third last part of this basics understanding of the evaluation of bone tumor is soft tissue extensions. Means soft tissue growth from the tumor into the surrounding. Likely to be malignant, like metastasis or sarcomas, these are the conditions where we see this growth. Where exceptions, apart from malignancy, the giant cell tumor and simple bone cyst, they are the two extensions where we can see soft tissue extension also. X-ray, they are typically showing difference between benign and malignant is assessed by evaluating the association between adjacent fat planes. And blood fat planes means basically MRI is essential along with the X-rays. MRI is essential for the evaluation of the soft tissue extensions. And now soft tissue findings, they help in differential diagnosis. So along with X-ray, we are doing MRI. But these two important points I want to make you understand. The myositis ossificans and periosteal type of osteogenic sarcoma. Here, we should think of regarding the soft tissue findings. The when the myositis ossificans actually matures from periphery to center, which is other way around in the osteogenic sarcoma. And the signs actually and likely diagnosis. Whenever we will see phlebolith is there, we think of hemangioma. Fat density, we think of lipoma. Amorphous radiodensity with areas of bone formation, we think of myositis ossificans or peristial OGS, and punctate clumps of radio density near a joint along with tendency, we think of synovial sarcoma. So multiplicity of lesions, when there are multiple lesions, we are thinking of benign, then our differential should be fibrous dysplasia, multiple enchondroma, or oleus disease, or Maffucci's syndrome is nothing but enchondromas plus hemangiomas and hemophilic pseudotumors. But multiple lesions and aggressive lesion, then multiple myeloma, lymphoma, and metastasis remains our differential. Touch me not lesions or lesions not to be biopsied. The tumor or tumor-like lesions like cortical defect or non-swaying fibroma or periosteal desmoid or solitary fibrous dysplasia, myositis ossificans, or ganglion or enchondromas, and non-neoplastic conditions where you will not go for biopsy is the healing avulsion fractures, bone infarct, inostosis or bone island, hemophilic pseudotumor, degenerative cyst, brown tumors of hyperparathyroidism. So at the end of all these 10 points, this slide I am trying to summarize, that is, whenever we see well-defined sclerotic borders, geographic type of pattern of destruction, continuous solid type of periosteal reactions, and no soft tissue infiltration, we think of benign bone lesions. Whereas poorly defined borders, wide zone of transition, moth eaten or permittive type of pattern of destruction, interrupted periosteal reactions with soft tissue infiltration, we think of malignant lesions. Here I finish the basic 10 points we should remember in evaluation of the tumors. But this metabolic bone diseases being a small part, I don't want to keep it at the end. So I am taking these 3-4 conditions in the beginning. First is hyperparathyroidism. And remember, in hyperparathyroidism, increased calcium and decreased phosphorus. These two important things you have to remember. And how patient will present to you? Polyuria, polydipsia, bony pains, nephrocalcinosis, ureteric colitis, and renal colic, like in MEN syndrome. And radiologically, mainly findings, we divide in subgroups like bone resorption, brown tumor formation, osteosclerosis, and chondrocalcinosis. So pathophysiology explains radiological findings. Like here, subperiosteal bone resorption at medial cortex, or radial cortex of middle phalanx of index and middle finger usually suggests us resorption type. This paper and pot type of appearance of skull we will see in short time. Brown tumor or Rugger Jersey spine. So these findings, they are basically because of the increased parathyroid hormone affecting at bone level, kidney level, or intestinal level. And on bone, action of PTH, we see is the osteoclastic activity, thereby increasing the calcium and calcium and phosphorus from the bone, and it increases the serum calcium. Here both are released, but see here, when kidney's function is increases tubular reabsorption of calcium but excretes phosphate. So phosphates is reduced, calcium is increased. And from intestines, vitamin D metabolism and calcium absorption, they are the important parts, because vitamin D normal level is essential for the normal absorption of calcium. So mainly osteoclastic activity, and at some instances, osteoblastic activity, like in secondary type of hyperparathyroidism. With this, net results is resorption of the bone because of osteoclastic activity and fibrous tissue replacement at the resorbed area with vascular type of tissue, fibrovascular. We call it as osteitis fibrosa cystica is another name. And also seen in von Recklinghausen's disease of the bone. So what this will do, the ultimate result will be decreased bone density, brown tumor formation, subperiosteal bone resorption, and defective lamellar or Iversian canal system. Now, one by one, these 4 points of hyperparathyroidism, bone resorption, which is a hallmark, cortical bone resorption over the cancellous one. We can see here, this is the index finger, middle phalanx, and radial. This is little finger, thumb is we are not seeing. So this is index finger, middle phalanx, and thumb side, that is radial surface scalloping is there. So subperiosteal, which is pathognomy. Earliest is radial side of middle phalanx of index and middle fingers resorption is there. Loss of fine cortical outline around the tufts and leads to mesh-like or woven bone appearance. Also seen at medial aspects of proximal tibia, femur, humerus, superior or inferior rib margins or lamina dura surrounding the teeth. Another important salt and pepper skull. So osteoclasts dissect through the center of trabeculae resulting in stippled, mottled or granular appearance, which loses clear distinction between inner and outer table of the skull. On my right side, there is the inner and outer table of the skull very well seen, but this differentiation is lost on the left side, which is a salt and pepper appearance of the skull. And this is called the basically loss of clear distinction between inner and outer table of the skull will give the appearance of salt and pepper skull, and basic pathology remains osteoclastic activity leading to bone resorption. Now, brown tumor formation or osteoclastoma. Parathyroid hormone stimulates osteoclastic activity. Extensive bone resorption occurs, and especially this brown tumor formation is primarily seen in primary type of hyperparathyroidism. How does it occur? Locally, this resorbed bone is replaced by vascularized fibrous tissue, and hence the name osteitis fibrosa cystica, which contains actually this area is replaced, bony area is replaced with this tissue, which contains giant cells, necrosis, and hemorrhagic liquefaction. And lesion is itself eccentric, cortical, expansile, lytic, well-marginated lesion with endosteal scalloping and no periosteal reaction. So more than complication of pathological fracture is inevitable when this cortical loss exceeds more than 2/3. And of course, differentials of metastasis, we should always remember here. Now, Roger Jersey spine. So basically, there is a differential this osteosclerosis or bone deposit formation, new bone is more dense, radio dense, and gives the end plates, vertebral end plates, they give these hyper intense appearance. So how it is, osteosclerosis or increased bone density in secondary hyperparathyroidism means long standing untreated hyperparathyroidism in chronic kidney disease is usually where we see this type of spinal appearance. Here, normally hyperparathyroidism causes osteoclastic activity, but here in this secondary type, that is chronic kidney disease with secondary hyperparathyroidism, osteoblastic activity also occurs there in addition to clastic activity. Thereby, there is a difference in density of normal mineralized bone here as against newly formed unmineralized bone, that is osteoid, at the vertebral end plates, effectively giving this appearance. Now, second disease is rickets or osteomalacia, another very important. With these three diseases, I am explaining concept-based part, so I am taking a little more time. So in etiology, abnormal vitamin D metabolism is responsible for these rickets. Here is incomplete or defective mineralization. Remember, rickets or osteomalacia, defective or incomplete mineralization. Whereas scurvy, normal mineralization or unaffected mineralization, but the problem is somewhere else, we will see in short. So vitamin D is a steroid hormone in diet. It is in pro-vitamin D3 form when comes in skin and comes this ultraviolet ray. When stimulate this part, it activates and undergoes into two hydroxylations. First one in the liver forming 25 hydroxy vitamin D3 and second hydroxylation in kidney. And the main role of vitamin D is calcium and phosphate homeostasis. The affected organs basically in these diseases mainly are bones, GI tract, kidneys, and parathyroid glands. So abnormal, what are the causes? Abnormal vitamin D metabolism, three things we should think of. Primarily is diet, means in abnormal metabolism, dietary deficiency of vitamin D or inadequate sunlight exposure. Maybe having some gastrointestinal tract like malabsorption state creating diseases, liver disorders, anticoagulant therapy, anticonvulsant therapy, patient on anticonvulsants or renal insufficiency leads to abnormal vitamin D metabolism. Now, secondary phosphate loss leads to vitamin D resistant rickets, renal tubular acidosis, tumor associated or chemotherapeutic drug induced, and miscellaneous form like metaphyseal chondrodysplasia and hypophosphatasia. So in rickets, investigations, important is alkaline phosphatase you will always find raised and reduced to our normal calcium or phosphorus. So important investigations, blood investigations, alkaline phosphatase. Clinical features, less than 6 months life in children, they may have tetany or convulsions. In older children, stunted growth, slow and tender joints in symptomatic kids. Advanced disease, irritability, bony deformities and weakness. And in adults, in osteomalacia, there is a fatigue, malaise, bone pains, abnormal gait and proximal muscular weakness. So now, this is radiologically important slides, few slides of these rickets are there. We all know these increased unossified tissue at the metaphyses, cupping, splaying, fraying of metaphyses. And I think this theoretical part, students should go in detail. And at wrist level, widening of growth plate, irregular margin of metaphyses with widening and cupping, osteopenia, rarefaction in long joint, skeletal deformity, skull, craniotapes, long bones, bowings, spine, scoliosis, triradiate pelvis, and rachitic rosary. So these are the overall areas where we can find the objective findings. Why there is a widening of growth plate? Because earliest and specific radiological change occurs, it is due to increase in cartilaginous cell mass. So radiologically, view immature skeleton, two views, expanded distal ends of the radius, flaring, cupping, fraying at metaphysis ridge, widened growth plates, coarse trabeculations, we think of rickets. So signs of healing rickets, this is the questions may be asked during VIVA. So radiological signs of healing occur within 2 to 3 weeks of adequate therapy and complete recalcification occurs in 2 months. So 2 to 3 weeks and 2 months. So what are the findings we see? Resurgence of dense zone of provisional calcification as seen as a dense line of short of metaphyses. First evidence of healing. Increased cupping. Recalcification of subperiosteal osteoid forming a thick opaque envelope along the shaft. Epiphyseal ossification center becomes sharply defined. We can find these all findings of healing rickets, radiological findings. So usually radiological picture we will see this way. Then questions usually asked in classical features seen, describe the classical, what classical features of rickets you will see, probable diagnosis or how will you evaluate and manage the case. Now we shift our focus towards the scurvy. The last metabolic disease I would like to discuss in the today's series. Vitamin C deficiency is the cause. Acts as a, and why vitamin C is important? It acts as a cofactor in collagen formation. So essential element in manufacturing the cartilage matrix. And hence deficiency causes reduced osteoblastic activity and cellular content in the bone is also reduced. Thereby mineralization is unaffected, but osteoblastic activity is reduced and collagen formation becomes defective. So this picture is important. We'll summarize the classical findings of radiology. So just watch subperiosteal hemorrhages. You can see this is white line of Frenkel, and there is some gap here called as Rummerfeld or scorbutic zone. This is a sclerotic ring, Wimberger sign, and they towards the longitudinal axis at this metaphyseal junction there is a calcified dense spur-like appearance of overgrowth, that is Pelican spur. So what is this scorbutic zone? This is a radiolucent zone in the metaphysis below the Frenkel's line. Occurs due to decreased formation of bony matrix in the zone of primary and secondary spongiosa. and this is weakened the bone and shows tendency to the fracture. So radiological features: osteopenia, suppressed blastic activity and normal plastic activity leads to osteopenia is the answer. Dense zone of provisional calcification, white line of Frankel, this region at growing metaphysis. Why? Although cartilage proliferation is decreased, mineralization is normal and unimpaired, and due to normal mineralization, zone of provisional calcification becomes wide and dense, and hence there is a flaring up of the metaphysis. Now, important ring epiphysis. See this, called Imberger sign. The peripheral margin of epiphysis appears dense, but central portion is radiolucent. This circular or rounded epiphysis. Then corner angle sign. Irregularity of the metaphyseal margin frequently occurs secondary to infarctions of the epiphyseo-metaphyseal junction. Irregular metaphyseal lines. That is the corner angle sign. And Pelican spur, see this four marked area, region, or this region. What is it? The bony protuberances, that is nothing but the periosteal elevation, occurs at the metaphyseal margins and lead to spur formation at right angles away from the shaft's longitudinal axis. And just to complete the list, acromegaly and fluorosis, you just remember the radiological part. The basic pathology in acromegaly is after epiphyseal fusion or closure, excessive growth hormone secretions will lead to enlarged sinuses or protrusion of the mandible, thickened cranial vault, enlarged celatasica or other features in the body, and acromegaly diagnosis, radiological diagnosis, with all those features you should read. And in fluorosis, important findings, we see this ossification of intraosseous membrane in forearm and ossification of the ligaments in the pelvis. They are the radiological findings in the fluorosis. Rest detailed part, I will request you to go through it. Now we start with our bone tumor part in two parts, means we have learned how to evaluate now. So now here, malignant tumors, four or five tumors I'm going through is the osteosarcoma in first in the list. 75% cases occur in the second and third decade. Metaphysis of the distal femur, proximal humerus are the most common sites. Lesion in the metaphysis of long tubular bones, sunburst or sunray periosteal response, sclerotic, lytic or mixed type of lesions, and ghost cortex is preserved. These are the salient features we have already discussed, but now specifically we are going one by one. So important point, again, this figure is simplest to draw in exam also for writing theory question. Cloud-like new bone formation, cortical destruction, soft tissue component of invagination, and Cordman triangle. These are the points you should remember. And actually, this osteogenic sarcoma is a very big topic. Every other type is having some sort of other radiological findings. So I leave it to you. But this picture on right side, they are the various types. Intraosseous type is again five types, surface osteogenic sarcoma, and other extraosseous multicentric or secondary, I request you to read. So osteogenic sarcoma, you should tell in the exam, first view of the knee, means view of the x-ray, whether adequate exposure or not, whether skeleton is mature or immature, which site, and then what sort of pattern is there, what sort of geographical means what sort of lesion is there. So geographical lesion, well-defined, blastic type of pattern, no bony changes, periosteal osteogenic sarcoma. Now here, the x-ray of a mature skeleton, well exposed, showing the anteroposterior and lateral view of the femur with knee joint, diaphyseal affected area, cortex is affected, mixed lytic and blastic type of activity is seen, ill-defined borders, cortex thinned from outside, periosteal reaction, and Codman's triangle. Here and here you can make out malignant features. They all suggest aggressive with these malignant features, and hence we can think of periosteal osteogenic sarcoma. Now different variety again. Again, you will describe the exposure, site of the which X-ray, which view, type of skeleton, location, whether it is a lytic or sclerotic, lesion type, cortex affected area, periosteal reaction, whether it is there or not, and Codman's triangle or lamellated appearance. These features are malignant, and diagnosis goes to telangiectatic osteogenic sarcoma. Again, you will describe in the same way. I will not waste time in detail. Just I am running through the slides now. Metaphyseal, mixed type, sunburst appearance, wide zone of transition, ghost cortex. Now see here, though the lesion is there, you can clearly make out the cortical outline. Ghost cortex is preserved, and hence we reach to the diagnosis of osteogenic sarcoma. Now chondrosarcoma is our second part tumor. So it is a cartilage origin tumor. Chondroblast and collagenoblast, they are the culprits. Means the cause of this overgrowth produce cartilaginous and collagenous type of tumors. Third most common malignant bone tumor. First one is osteogenic sarcoma. Second one is multiple myeloma. And this is the third one type malignant type of most commonly seen tumor. And this tumor can, this secondary is from enchondroma, osteochondroma, CMF and chondroblastoma. They may lead to the chondrosarcoma. So here important is central lesion, epicenter intramedullary. If peripheral, epicenter is at the bone surface. Central, large osteolytic, endosteal reaction, matrix mineralization, popcorn type or stippled nodular ring and arc type pattern. Mature bone, again, how will you describe? Again, description remains the same. Well exposed, radiograph of so-and-so body part with so-and-so views in a mature or immature skeleton, and then you will go from either soft tissues to the center, outside in or inside out. So confined to the bone, lytic and sclerotic type, fluffy calcification, cortical erosion, chondrosarcoma is the diagnosis. Now Ewing's sarcoma, most cases occur between 10 to 25 years of age group, mimics infection. So Ewing's sarcoma, always remember your diagnosis, chronic osteomyelitis or infection remains your most common differential. So age group is important. Infection may occur in other ages too. May mimic infection, diaphyseal permeative lesion, femur tibia fibula commonly affected, onion skin periosteal response is the hallmark, most common primary malignant bone tumor to metastasize to the bones. So how it appears? Central diaphyseal permeative type of lesion with wide zone of transition, saucerization features, all you can see in this radiograph. And why it is called onion pill? So this is self-explanatory picture, and below is the drawing. Saucerization, tumor grows through Havassian system and presents subperiosteally. That is marginal scalloping effect on the surface leads to laying out of these layers. So periosteal reaction is multilaminar, onion peel type. Codman triangle is there. So this suggests aggressive, recurrent, metastatic or skip lesions. These four points one must remember. So immature skeleton, diaphysis, periosteal reaction is here. Onion peel, lamellar type reaction, cortical thickening is there, medulla is normal, so diagnosis goes to Ewing sarcoma. Again, same. So now we move to the next one. Second most hematological malignancy, second most common. Clonal proliferation of plasma cells which produce excessive amount of monoclonal immunoglobulin. This immunoglobulin is detected in serum and urine, commonly seen in fifth decade and above, most common in males compared to females. Uniform size, multiple pulsed out lytic lesions without sclerotic rim in the skull. This radiograph tells us that the person is suffering from the multiple myeloma as one of our diagnoses. And whenever we will find such, then examiner may ask you, would you like to do skeletal survey? And what you will do in skeletal survey? AP and lateral view of the skull, cervical and thoracic and lumbosacral spine, again AP lateral view, chest X-ray AP view, pelvis with both hips AP view, and long bones, especially proximal part is usually affected, AP views. So this should one should tell for the skeletal survey at least this mister. In long bone also we can see this. So lytic lesion with permeative type of pattern of bone destruction here we are seeing. So in long bones where it is, how it will look? You can correlate these words with this radiograph. Discrete, small lytic lesions up to less than 1 centimeter. Moth-eaten pattern of cortical destruction, and if affected area is more than 2/3 or up to 2/3 of the cortex, may cause pathological fracture with trivial trauma. Again, same, this is more clear radiograph. In fact, infiltrate normal marrow and hampers. So what is the pathophysiology here? Why these sign symptoms we see? Because this infiltration of normal marrow, which hampers the myelopoiesis, means normal bone marrow cell production is affected. Thereby, what is the role of normal bone marrow? It affects the RBC production, thereby leads to anemia. Whenever there is anemia, because of this infection, cytopenia occurs, and infections are more common with cytopenic patients. Renal insufficiency, hypercalcemia due to activation of osteoclast, demineralization of bones. They are actually the reasons for the various sign symptoms patients are presenting to us. So now read this radiograph. We should tell the view, type of skeleton, location, scanty periosteal reaction, cortices are thinned out and breached, medulla is moth eaten. So diagnosis is the metastasis. So with this, I try to finish the malignant part, radiological features of the bone tumors. Now benign bone tumors and a huge Pandora box. So at least my today's aim is actually to clear the concepts. So first in our list is bone island. This is very self-explanatory drawing on left side. So oval, densely sclerotic, intramedullary lesion, aligned along the long axis of trabeculae. So what differentials you will keep in mind? Osteoblastic mets. So bone scan, now bone scan, no increased tracer uptake by inostosis. In this type of bone islands, bone scan will be negative. On MRI, hypo-intense signal in both T1 and T2, and they are the important in differentiating from the osteoblastic mets. Now read this radiograph. Again, same way we have to go. We have to tell the lateral view of the cervical spine. Exposure is adequate. Body part is radiographed. View you have told. Skeleton mature or immature. Type of lesion. See the C1. There is a lytic lesion with sclerotic margin. That is type 1A. So lytic lesion with surrounding hyperostosis. Posterior arch of C1 is affected. Well-defined geographical lesion with sclerotic rim. Cortex is expanded. So this is clearly telling us no periosteal reaction. So lesion is benign. And osteoblastoma is the diagnosis. Now next is osteoma. That is benign bone tumor of membranous bone or hematoma. The most common site is skull, paranasal sinuses, and mandible. And sign symptoms, usually these patients are asymptomatic. X-ray radiological picture, well circumscribed lesion arising from the cortex and protrudes from the surface. Bone and osteoma, they have the same density. and Gardner syndrome, where osteoma plus colonic polyposis means two conditions are there. This osteoma, when it is associated with colonic polyposis, is called as Gardner syndrome. So third in list and most common, osteoid osteoma again, osteoid plus Wuhan bone formation. So lesion is typically less than 1.5 centimeter. Age group is second and third decade. Pain, tenderness in the lesion, especially night, and dramatic relief with aspirin or salicylic within 20 to 30 minutes is the clinical diagnostic complaint. So most commonly affected areas are upper ends of femur or tibia, posterior elements in the spine, skull, mandible, and ribs or ischium, they are another affected areas. So you can see on this diagrammatic picture on your right upper side, dense sclerotic lesion with solid periosteal reaction in tibial diaphysis. Here, the lesion is with calcified nidus and sclerosis. So here we go. View of and skeletal. Site is diaphyseal. Affected part is cortex. Blastic with well-defined lytic area in the center, that is nidus, the black part, and cortical hyperostosis. No periosteal reaction. Characteristic location, age, X-ray, and history will lead you to the osteoid osteoma. Now is osteochondroma, most common, enough discussed in our these classes also. So I will just run through the slide. Osteochondroma is probably the most common of all primary bone tumors. You should remember this picture. Osteochondromas are seen as a sessile or pedunculated lesion that flare out from the bone surface with cortical density of their stalk. Medulla of the bone of the origin is in continuity with the medulla of the lesion, and cortical, this cartilaginous cap is there. So osteochondroma always grows away from the joint because of differential growth, which is self-explanatorily shown in this picture. So next, we are moving to the enchondromas. Cartilaginous growth in medullary cavity, asymptomatic, painless swelling to start with. Continued growth of benign residual rests of cartilage displaced from the growth plate is the pathology. Usually they are solitary, and almost 40% or almost near to half cases we find in the metacarpal and metatarsal short long bones. So radiological picture, oval, geographical oval lesion, geographical destruction with lobulated contour, endosteal scalloping, ground glass matrix, dystrophic calcification, which gives rings and arcs appearance, and no periosteal reaction, that is intact cortex. Now I'm running just quickly, keep watching. Enchondroma. So chondroblastoma is the next tumor. Eccentric type of epiphyseal region tumor. Cartilaginous type of tumor. Common in age is second decade. Two-third cases, epiphyses around the knee is almost, around the knee, almost two-third cases. Proximal femur is the next common site. Proximal tibia and distal femur first. And then comes proximal femur. Well-defined sclerotic margin with intact scalloped cortical borders. Periosteitis of adjacent metaphyses. So differentials you should remember now. Avascular necrosis of the femoral head, giant cell tumor, and CMF and enchondroma. Now, read this radiograph. Lesion area is here. So immature skeleton, knee anterior posterior view, well exposed radiograph. In an immature skeleton, epiphyseal location, lytic type of lesion, geographical lesion, well-defined margins, non-sclerotic rims, that is 1B type, cortex, no thinning or breach, no periosteal reaction, chondroblastoma is the diagnosis. So chondromyxoid fibroma is our next tumor. Age is second and third decade, eccentric type in metaphyseal region, 60% occur in long bones. So what are the radiological findings? Expansile, ovoid lesion with lesion center, long axis of lesion is parallel to the long axis of host bone. Geographic bone destruction with scalloped margins and expanded cell. Stippled calcification within tumor in advanced cases. No periosteal reactions. 25, almost 1/4 recur. So differentially here, bone cyst, aneurysmal bone tumor, non-specifying fibroma, fibrous dysplasia, and enchondroma. So this picture will still make our job a bit easier. That is fibrous cartilaginous defect and non-ossifying fibroma is the next lesion we are looking. Benign type of fibrous lesions. Non-ossifying fibroma is eccentric one. And focal cortical, the fibrous cortical defect is superficially, which affects the cortex. Site is commonly around the knee. Histopathologically, fibrous tissue, xanthoma cells and giant cells, they are seen. Radiologically, our main today's class, radiological picture is well marginated, eccentric, lytic with sclerotic margins, lytic lesions with sclerotic margins may appear multiloculated due to corrugations. And differentials, again, bone cyst, aneurysmal, simple bone cyst, aneurysmal bone cyst, fibrous dysplasia and chondromyxoid fibroma. Now, describe this. Well-exposed X-ray of ankle with distal tibia fibula. Anteroposterior, it is not perfectly antero AP view because the we are not seeing properly the joint. Immature skeleton or mature skeleton. Here it should be actually mature skeleton. Sorry for the mistake. Metaphyseal region, lytic type of lesion. Geographical lesion with well-defined and sclerotic rim, thinned out cortex without breach, no periosteal reaction. So diagnosis is fibrous cortical defect. Again, see here, mature or immature skeleton, lytic, same way, and you will reach to the non-ossifying fibroma as a diagnosis. So now, this is again, like osteogenic sarcoma in malignant, this fibrous dysplasia is again a big topic. Go through it in detail, but remember only few things. So normal bone undergoes physiological resorption. This mechanism is very important and is simplified in this slide. So remember from this slide, there is a normal bone which undergoes physiological resorption normally. But after physiological resorption, which is normally to be replaced by normal osteoid tissue, is replaced by abnormal proliferation of an isomorphous fibrous tissue of spindle cells and poorly formed bony trabeculae of one bone. It is of three types, in single bone affected, many bones affected, or many bones with some endocrine disorder, and hence monoostrotic, polyostrotic, polyostrotic endocrine disorders in with 70, 27 and 3% incidence accordingly. So monoostrotic type, peak age of incidence, and there is no gender prediction in monoostrotic polyostrotic, but the syndromic type, polyostrotic with endocrine abnormality, the female prediction is there. So difference between mono and polyostrotic features, polio in polyostrotic, what do you see? Involvement of shoulder, perivigirdle, craniofacial skeleton or vertebral column affects entire limbs. Severity of deformities is there. Increased incidence of spontaneous or recurrent fractures. In monoostrotic, it itself is a single bone affected. So fibrous dysplasia. In case of monoostrotic, what you will see? Well-defined lucent lesion at a diametaphyseal ridge zone, loculated ground glass matrix, thick sclerotic rim or rind of sclerosis, we say, endoosteal scalloping, thinning of cortex, expansion, maybe there, deformity may be there or fracture may be there. And in polyostrotic, in skull, crossing of the sutures, wide dipolic space, obliterated sphenoid or frontal sinuses, in orbit, it may push the inferolateral displacement of the orbital contents, occiput or mandibular cystic lesions, deformity, proptosis or cranial nerve compressions could be there. In pelvis, bubbly cystic lesions, fusiform enlargement, loss of normal trabecular pattern. So now read this. Fibrous dysplasia. Shepherd-Cook deformity. So in polyostotic, in extremities, what you will see? Short stature in adult, dwarfism, premature ossification center fusion, Boeing deformities could be there, limb-leg discrepancies, Shepherd-Cook deformity or Coxa-Vara, pseudoarthrosis in infancy or premature osteoarthritis may also be seen. As against polyostotic fibrous dysplasia, extremities, Shepherd-Cook deformity, Coxa-Vara and pseudoarthrosis. In pelvis, protrusio type acetabulum. Ribs, extrapleural signs will be there. Pseudo fractures, incremental fractures or vertebral collapse. So these differentials here, again, if monoostotic, think of non-ossifying fibroma, simple bone cyst, GCT, enchondroma, Ewing's eosinophilic granuloma. Polyostotic. Here differential is Paget's, neurofibromatosis, hyperparathyroidism, and osteofibrous dysplasia. Now we move to some other form of lesions like aneurysmal bone cyst. This picture, as if just forget everything and watch this picture, the balloon part. What it tells us, expansile metaphyseal lesion with ballooning, fine septations inside and fluid levels. If you see on radiograph, it is aneurysmal bone cyst. So what is the pathophysiology? Intraosseous AV malformation is there. Honeycombing of spaces. These spaces are filled with blood products. It is named because of its radiographic appearance. And it has nothing to do with histopathological findings as an aneurysmal bone cyst. So what I said, this appears as if this artery is ballooned. Means as if there is an aneurysmal type of problem. So it is the radiological appearance and for the reason of the name, for the sake of name, nothing to do with histopathological finding. For that means this name is misnomer. So commonly seen in 5 to 20 years of age, most commonly, I mean almost three-fourth cases, and female preponderance is there. So now again, metaphyseal lesion, eccentric in long bones, central diaphyseal in small tubular long bones, expansile, rapidly growing, sacular and lytic, multiple fine septi, sharply bulging scalloped borders, honeycombing appearance or soap bubble appearance, blown out appearance. These are the different terminologies. So affects them again. Try to read this. Exposure, body part x-ray, view, and now lesion in the side, metaphyseal one. Posterior elements in vertebrae, lesion is closely associated with physis. Primary aneurysmal bone cyst is rare in skeletally mature individuals. So I will just run through this. Now this radiograph, I think this is the diagnostic one. Location, so view, type of skeleton, site, then which area, say metaphyseal, centric, lytic, geographical, well-defined, expansile cortex, and breach in the, that is fracture there, breach in the cortex, this cortical fragment fallen inside the lesion, we call it as a fallen leaf sign, characteristic of this lesion. So diagnosis is unicaramal bone cyst or simple bone cyst. So radiologically, cyst is located in metaphyseal region, grows away from the physis. Fallen leaf sign is pathognomonic of the simple bone cyst. Now here, immature skeleton, diaphyseal region here, lytic and central, geographical lesion well defined with non-sclerotic margin, cortex is thin, periosteal reaction is whether it is there or not. So diagnosis comes to eosinophilic granuloma. Now I am just going to run through the slides. Majority part is over. Now I hope you will start reading with me. So AP and lateral of the wrist, mature skeleton, EP metaphyseal zone, eccentric, lytic, geographical lesion well defined with cortex thinned and breached also. trabeculation scene and characteristic radiograph location and age. Seen. Sir?
Your screen is not seen.
Screen is not seen, sir.
For us, it is seen, sir. For us.
Last 3-4 slides, screen, we are not able to see the screen.
Are able to see the screen, sir.
Okay.
No, my screen is coming. We are able to see.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. I will go through again.
You are seeing?
Now can you see?
Yes, sir. Again, sir.
Now you are sharing, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
sir. I will go back now. Was I here?
Yeah,
yes, you were. Yes, it was there. Here, yeah.
Okay, sir. Now?
This was not.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Location, bone, then type of lesion, fracture, and this cortical part inside. So now read with me: anteroposterior view of shoulder, immature skeleton, metaphyseal region, centric type lesion, it is a lytic type lesion, geographical and well-defined lesion, expansile cortex, fallen lip sign is there, characteristic radiograph, location, age, suppose age is also in first 2-3 decades, and diagnosis is simple bone cyst. So radiologically important is metaphyseal region. It grows out from the physis, and one thing important you should remember is fallen lip sign. It is because of fracture occurs there and cortical fragment falls within, and it looks like as if a dry leaf falls on the ground from the tree, that sort of appearance, and hence the name. So now here, immature skeleton, diaphysis, lytic, central type, geographical lesion, well-defined with non-sclerotic rim, cortical thinning, peristyle reaction, and eosinophilic granuloma. Now I am just rushing through the slides. You will read with me. This is no way to, but it is the giant cell tumor. Again, giant cell tumor. See here now. Bones are okay, little swelling of the fingers, joints are free, pigmentation of the skin, soft tissue. Watch this carefully. So it is the
cavernous hemangioma.
Yes. So now this is adamantium picture. So I have just rushed through it. Sir, how much time do I have? Okay. So 10 more minutes. So now, sir, I will just go through the x-rays, let the students see for another 5 minutes, and then I will stop. So important is radiologically, minimum 10 days in extremities and 21 days in spine are required for radiological pickup. This picture, you should now describe the way talk, and this is nothing but the dead bone. So Sivanand sir's 4 Ds, if you have attended that day's class, you just diameter, dimension, dead bone, and gap or zone.
Density.
So I'm not going in details. I have finished today's class, but I am just showing this is Brody's abscess, trauma. Now just tell me, any students will, not more than 2 seconds you will take and you will tell. This is the posterior radial dislocation. Now, anyone?
Anterior dislocation.
Now describe this x-ray the way I told you. This is well exposed pelvis with both hips, AP view in a mature skeleton showing both hip bones and hip joints with your findings now. Broken central line on left side, and the head is below the acetabulum and medial, and hip joint appears to be abducted, suggestive of. So likewise, this is knee dislocation, shoulder dislocation, elbow dislocation, again here, Montegia fracture dislocation, Can you read this? Okay. Now, just I will just finish in next 2 to 3 bony ankylosis. Samantha sir's class very well explained all these things to us. Diagnosis already written there. Scaffe. Hey, this one, NEPG.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Here.
GDH.
Okay. So you should know H line, Hilzinger's line, Perkins line, acetabular index, broken central line, medial gap. So, diagnosis. I am just going. Now, this is which implant?
Angle blade.
Angle blade plate. So, what is this?
Resurfacing.
Hip resurfacing.
Okay. Birmingham's. Okay.
What is this?
Is it normal? Normally seen like this? If no. Specific pathology is there?
Okay. Bony ankylosis.
Okay. What is here? You see? See here. Okay. I'm rushing forward. What do you see here?
Listasis LPS1.
Okay. What you see here?
Osteoarthritis.
So what are the radiological classification of this?
KOS.
Go back and read these types. Okay.
Kellgren's lines.
Now see here disc. T2-weighted image with desiccated disc and backward. Means protruded or extruded disc. We are not having axial cut, so we cannot really say it is extruded or what, but it is compressing. Here, diagnosis. This is the area affected, Bennett's fracture dislocation.
First metatarsal.
Yes. Now, what is this?
Bosworth screw.
So, what is the procedure?
AC joint dislocation.
Scaphoid, non-union. Okay, what is this?
Syndesmotic.
Can you see the arrow I am placing?
Yes.
Okay, so when you will put and when you will not put this screw?
Sir, if there is syndesmotic injury, after fixation, we have to check intraoperatively by hook test, cotton test, or other radiological parameters like telocrural angle, medial space, as well as the distance between the tibia and the fibula. And
see, with radiograph, can you think of this? Yes, this gap and this area. Okay, we'll also preoperatively make you plan like that way. Syndactyly, what is this diagnosis?
Radial club hand. Radial club hand.
So friends, see these books, okay, this slide. These are the books I have referred and I am grateful to Jayant Sharma sir, also AJ Thakur sir, and one Navy radiologist, Surgeon Lieutenant Commander Dr. Isha Rajput. And this book is exclusively on musculoskeletal radiology. So I have taken help of these three books. So your addition and comments from seniors are welcome. Thank you, friends. I have finished my talk.
Dr. Gopal, they need not read any book if they just remember this lecture. That's the compliment we can give.
Thank you, sir.
I wish that you should have been there during my post graduation.
I was not lucky to be your student, sir.
Sir, Gopal, sir. Congratulations on a vast topic. It actually it needs 2 or 3 classes, but you covered in 1 class.
That's he has worked very hard. Yesterday I called him, he was busy in that preparing.
Sir, your hard work is visible, sir.
Sir, I think visible. Today I can take 6 to 7 hours sleep.
I thought 6 to 7 packs.
No, sir.
Sir, mausam aisa hai na.
Sir, I am misnomer. Though I am ex-service man, I am misnomer, sir.
Sir, one question to students. How do you differentiate between SBC and ABC? Lady Rajkali. ABC and SBC. And Shivanand used to tell me the width of the expansion is greater than the width of the growth plate in ABC. But SBC expansion is along the middle, along the axis of the medullary canal. That is the one thing we used to discuss in radiology. And another mnemonic from the Sivananda only, 5 E's for the DCT. E's, eccentric, expansive, epiphyseal, axial cracking, and treated by excision. 5 E's mnemonic. The students can remember that.
Sir, I am going
Sir,
I am going to get book from book of mnemonics from Sivanand sir.
We all should get it.
7 years.
And one more point.
Vivek sir.
Doctor closure. Epiphyseal closure. Eccentric. Expansile. Epiphyseal tumor. Axial crackling. And it needs extended curettes. Whenever it is required, it needs excision. These are the 7. 7 years,
so including treatment,
everything. If you know this, this is enough.
Okay. Yeah, Vivek, sir.
I think, kudos, Gopal, sir. It was a, fantastic even revision for me. I was just, watching each and every X-ray. And though you also had a sleepless night, tonight you can sleep, but you have given a sleepless night to the students. One important thing what students must remember, you see, after the description, what I have always felt like you say, okay, this is a mature skeleton, so and so, everything. See, it is better to start with, it's likely, most likely, it is a malignant lesion, likely to be. And I've always felt, because sometimes when you straight away say it's an osteosarcoma, some examiners may take it to offense. You can always say that it is a malignant lesion, and look, because it is in metaphysis, there is a Cordman's triangle, there's an metaphysis, are likely to be it is a osteosarcoma. Because once you say osteosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma, or let's say multiple myeloma, you have given a final histological. And histological diagnosis, you have to be very diplomatic in saying that. So you can say likely to be.
Likely to be, exactly.
So that nobody feels offensive about it. It's like, if you give a diagnosis of adamantinoma, bang on, you are in soup.
You are in soup.
You say that it's an adamantinoma, it's over. Story is over. Yes. Though it could be. So you can always say that, yes, these are the points. And I feel, sir, these are my possible 1 or 2 differential diagnoses. Likely is bigger is this one. The other lesser is this one.
And one more point I would like to add, Gopal, sir.
Sir.
And multiple myeloma usually produces the punched out regions. And in ribs and clavicles, they can produce expansive regions. One point, I hope, Kakatka sir, what is your comment, sir?
Yeah,
I read in one of the books, sir. I have seen one case also.
Yeah.
Where in ribs and clavicle, they can produce expansive lesions.
But in the Vivek, sir, can produce even punched out lesions.
Normally punched out lesions, yeah. But it can produce expansive lesions.
There is multiple myeloma. Important point to be remembered regarding the multiple myeloma. This is one of the malignant bone tumor which gives a cold spot mostly on the bone scan. So somebody says that I want to proceed further, to find out whether it is there else in the body or not. If you say bone scan for, multiple myeloma, it is a wrong answer, because it is usually, it gives a cold spot. Unless there is an associated fracture where there is some new, vascularity has creeped in. Otherwise, it's a cold spot. Other malignant tumors are usually hot spot, but this is one cold spot. So one has to be very careful in this answer. And sometimes they also ask, you know, the minute you go from X-ray, then you say, how will you confirm? You say biopsy. The next question invariably is, what are the rules of biopsy? It is like digressing from X-ray to biopsy rules. And yeah. Biopsy is always performed at the end. And the classic examples are because certain tumors can actually be diagnosed with the help of blood investigation straight away. Like multiple myeloma is the classic example. If you get a strong M band, you know, you need not to go for a very formal biopsy, just a bone marrow aspiration also is enough. So biopsy should be reserved at the end. And sometimes they also ask, how will you confirm the diagnosis? So X-rays, yeah, whatever you say, but X-rays are never confirmatory. X-rays are only likely to be suggestive, whatever. So ultimately, at the end of the day, the confirmatory investigation in bone tumor and often in the infection is always the biopsy. So students must remember the biopsy, rules of biopsy, and then henceforth.
And one more thing I would like to add, Gopal sir.
Sir.
And so any student can answer this, my question. How do you differentiate radiological between periosteal osteosarcoma and periosteal osteosarcoma?
So periosteal is a proximal femur diaphysis lesion, while periosteal is a on the distal femur back surface, and periosteal will be seen as a soft tissue protruding tumor sitting in a saucer of a bone, while this periosteal will tend to glove the bone.
Which are two?
No.
Which two bone tumors? Which two bone tumors? They are most common in females.
Sir, periosteal periosteal osteosarcoma will have a cartilaginous cap, sir, which will help in differentiating from the periosteal osteosarcoma, sir.
Oh, I remember there is a clear lucency between the cortex and the periosteal sarcoma, but there is no difference, the radial lucency between the cortex and the tumor in the periosteal osteosarcoma. I request seniors to clarify that.
Yes, sir. I will also request the seniors.
That is called swing sign. It is already described, sir.
Yes.
There is a lucency between the tumor and the bone. Then it is called, that is called swing sign. It is commonly seen in periosteal osteosarcoma.
Yeah.
And periosteal also most commonly posterior aspect of the femur.
That is the commonest site for periosteal.
I had one case, where I did the biopsy. It came out the tumor, but the patient developed the sciatic nerve palsy. So I still remember that case. They went to the Mild Natarajan's center, Sarayagar in Madras, Chennai. They did custom-made process, but still the patient is still alive. That almost happened almost 6-8 years back, sir. Almost.
I think the other DD for periosteal osteosarcoma is myositis ossificans.
Exactly.
So that has to be always remembered, especially the tumor, bone tumor, often they give a minor history of fall, like child had a fall from swing and followed by this pain and swelling. So if you see that lesion, there is always a possibility, especially if it is about 4 to 6 weeks, 8 weeks, you know, whether it is a periosteal osteosarcoma or myositis. So that has to be kept in mind.
A periosteal osteogenic sarcoma is diaphysis is the location.
Yes.
And that is one point. And in case of periosteal osteogenic sarcoma, the bony mass abutting or enveloping the distal femoral metaphysis. This is the metaphysis. So diaphysis and metaphysis. Secondly, location is the posterior part. And thirdly, periosteal osteogenic sarcoma is female preponderance compared to other carcinogenic tumors. And GCT, again, female preponderance, except these two tumors, rest all the tumors, they are either having no preponderance or male preponderance. String sign or cleavage plane of juxtacortical, this sign is in periosteal osteogenic sarcoma, sir.
Yeah, that we already discussed.
Yes.
Sir. One important point, periosteal osteosarcoma does not have Codman's triangle, whereas periosteal will have.
Yes, sir.
In exam, sir. If they are asked, they have to say differentiation on basis of quadrants triangle, present or not present.
Sir, why touch me not lesions not biopsied? I will request for seniors to answer this.
कामंता सर बहुत देर से चुप बैठे आज तो
सर आई एम चेंजिंग माय रोल एज अ नाउ आई विल टेक ओवर मैं एक सवाल पूछना चालू करता हूँ सीनियर्स प्लीज हेल्प मी
ट्यूमर में मेरा ज्यादा उतना ये नहीं है एक्सरे में डिस्कस ठीक है बट आई डोंट हैव रेड बट डोंट रिमेंबर मेनी ऑफ द इंट्रिकेट इश्यूज ऑफ ट्यूमर
गोपाल क्वेश्चन आसिफ लाइक ये दिस ऑसिफिकेशन मायोसाइटिस ऑसिफिकेशन इफ यू टच बिफोर मैच्योर सो इट विल क्रिएट मोर प्रॉब्लम सो नॉट टू टच इट दिस इज वन
माले सर है ना माले सर बताएंगे अभी
पर लास्ट में क्या क्वेश्चन पूछा
सर व्हाई टच मी नॉट लीजंस नॉट बायप्सिड
हेलो
विवेक सर
मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम दे आर यू नो द clinical diagnosis it depends upon situation to situation and if you are very sure that they are benign they are not going to you know expand they are completely harmless and as you know Kanojia sir also said that there are certain lesion if you go in touch it will create more trouble so that's how this general statement there is no this is not a hard and fast statement but this is a general statement once you have said okay this looks like to be this and you need not to touch
what is the difference between septation and trabeculation septas are within the tumor and trabeculae they are the bone
normal cancellous bone has trabeculation
yes sir I think yeah
and one more point to the question to the students and why you see onion peel appearance in Ewing sarcoma why not in Usher sarcoma
it's because of laying of I think I have explained in the slide
Sir, students.
Okay, sir.
Sir, Gopal, sir, you can explain, sir.
Sir, actually, sawal, please repeat the question, sir.
Why there is onion peel appearance is the Ewing sarcoma?
Sir, pathophysiologically, the laying out is from inside out, and layer by layer, this it is laid down. That is the reason actually.
And
interrupted type of periosteal reaction.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's what I want to expect in the answer from my student, sir. Yes, because yes. That is given in the one book called Pathology, Physiology, Radiology by Agatar and Kirkpatrick. He has given a very good description of all the radiology. If it is in the print, I think anybody can read that. There's very good points are given. What are the conditions in which you can see the onion peel appearance? What are the various conditions you can see? Sunray or sunburst appearance, that is all given in that book, sir. Sir, any seniors can help me. Do you remember that book, sir? Agatar Kirkpatrick, Physiology, Pathology, Radiology in Orthopedics. Agatar, sir.
I have not seen that.
It's a wonderful book, sir, but it is out of print now.
Okay.
There is one book which correlates briefly pathology and radiology. It's a radiology book, but it briefly correlates the pathology. That's a Grainger and Allison. So you can just photocopy or get only the orthopedic part. You know, during my PG. I haven't read it for long. Sometimes for PG classes, I do read Grainger and Allison. It very nicely, especially the common condition, it describes very well.
Sir, there is one question. Actually, I want senior support for this question. Why resorption on radial side mainly in hyperparathyroidism? Is index finger and middle finger radial surface is scalloped? Why only radial surface? I am also not having a reason for this, but this is the commonest finding, and it is not only index and middle finger. It can be seen in all other fingers also, but most commonly seen is radial surface of the index and middle fingers, middle phalanx. Kakatkar sir, any other view, sir, or reason for this radial side absorption?
See, it is like that. Some problems are in particular place. Like why myositis is in elbow and hip. So it is predisposition. Some we don't know so many times, but it happens on that side. This is to help our diagnosis.
There could be some reason, but I am not aware because I don't do much bone tumor work. So.
Sir, there is one more question. After extended curettage of giant cell tumor and cementing, say after 4-5 years, if no recurrence is there, is it necessary to remove the cement and again graft? Not
for
required.
GCT? No, not at all.
So I think that
I have done in few of my cases about 10 years, 11 years have passed and I have not touched them again. They just come once in a year for follow and we just tumor. Take.
Nobody should ever appear in my mouth. You know, if they don't know GCT, exostosis, osteosarcoma,
that's all.
Multiple myeloma, you know, fibrous dysplasia, the common 10 tumors, 5 benign, 5 malignant, don't even appear for Viva. If you don't know GCT, they will kill you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sandwich technique, which is now most commonly, you know.
Yeah, the sandwich technique is something which you have to know.
Absolutely.
I think there is one Tata cancer.
After 4 years GCT, you will see the sclerotic rim around the bone cement. Once it is a thick sclerotic ring means there is no point of recurrence. That is the one of the important radiological sign. Once you see the sclerotic rim around the bone cement, that means there is no recurrence. Mostly the recurrence of the GCT at the second year. This is the most important thing we must remember. Right? When it recurs, most commonly it recurs in the second year. And the cement advantage is you can very well recognize this recurrence with cement.
It can be picked up very fast. It's
very difficult to diagnose the early recurrence. Yes. That is the advantage of bone cement.
Even answer how it looks like? I mean, the earliest recurrence and then is it?
Earliest, there is a rarefaction around the bone cement area because bone cement will give you very good contrast and you will see the moth eaten appearance around the bone cement.
Because I had operated, I mean, many years back, about 7 years back. So he's from Tamil Nadu only. I mean, somehow he's a loyal patient. He comes from there. He had a GCT. So he developed a small radiolucent rim initially. And then I was like, what to do? Then I just let him go. Over the years, he has come, that radiolucent rim is around. That's it.
The duration is the most important thing. Most of the times, recurrence you see at that second year. You see the lucency in the beginning of the first year, that means it is because of the heat necrosis that is surrounding that the bone tumor area.
Okay.
In the initial first year period, most of the times they don't recur.
So that's why
they are given clearly, very clearly given in Resnick. Bone tumors. It is very clearly given after keeping the bone cement, most of the times the tumor will recur after a second year. Second year is the most crucial period.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
One last question to Gopal, sir. Gopal, sir.
Another important thing, most of the times examiners will ask why you use the bone cement. Advantage is bone cement, it is stable in the compression, but it is unstable in the rotation. That's why sometimes they use to keep the plate. Once you bone cement it and when you do the sandwich technique, why do you want to use the plate along with the bone cement? That means bone cement can only withstand the compressive loads, but it cannot withstand the torsional loads. To prevent the torsion, because it is a clear lytic area, once you bone cement it, any movement at the bone cement, it will kill the entire articular cartilage. It is just not to get the rotation at that bone cement area. You graft it, then you keep the bone cement, then you plate it. Then it never allow the bone cement. Even if it is something loose, it never allow it to move.
Okay.
So that's why they shifted from the bone cement to bone cement with plate.
Ragged spine is also seen in, if I remember, it's osteopetrosis. Am I right, sir?
क्या बोलिए उधर सर क्या बोलिए
रगर जैसे स्किन आल्सो सीन इन ऑस्टियोपेट्रोसिस
सर रगर जैसे दो इट इज सीन बट द सेकेंडरी टाइप ऑफ हाइपरपैराथायरॉइडिज्म देयर इज अ क्लियर कट डिस्टिंक्शन ड्यू टू डिफरेंशियल बोन फॉर्मेशन एंड हियर इट इज नॉट दैट क्लियरली ओनली वर्टिब्रल एंड प्लेट्स दे आर नॉट ओनली एंड प्लेट्स अफेक्टेड इन द ऑस्टियोपेट्रोसिस
रगर जैसे स्पाइन is commonly seen where there is a differential growth. That means differential growth means a bone turnover, differential bone turnover.
Yes,
I can say that. Wherever you will see the lysis along with the bone formation, in those situations, those conditions, you will see the recurrence pain. example, you will see the, what is that called? Renal rickets.
Renal rickets, okay. Yes.
You will see that. Why you see that? There you will see the a delayed, a layer by layer. One side it is the, there is no newborn formation. Once you start a treatment, then you will get the a newborn formation there. So you will get the alternative layers. That's why in renal rickets also, you will see the rickets just fine.
Renal
so,
osteodystrophy.
So osteopetrosis, exactly. Renal resistant rickets, and the hyperparathyroidism, secondary hyperparathyroidism. These are the 3 points students should remember.
Even in diabetic renal CKDs, you get this type of pictures.
Basically, CKD, long-standing CKD, not properly treated, is the word used in the books.
Yeah.
So student must remember a mnemonic called SNAP. This is very important. When you diagnose the bone tumors, SNAP means, it is very important. S means size and
site,
exactly. And at the N means number of tumors. That will give you a clue what type of tumor it is. And A means it is the age. Age always determines what is the thing.
Aggressive
and
also.
And P means whether it is painful or painless.
Sir, double A.
So if you know these things.
I used to teach them that there are two most important things, but now it is SNAP. So I always used to say the site and age. If you know the age of the tumor, I mean age of the patient, and if you know the site, then you are likely to be correct. But now it is SNAP.
Yes.
Sir, double A, aggressive and age, both.
If it is, number of tumors, site, and size, then that will give you entire
picture. Compile your mnemonics for bone tumors and share with us.
Yeah. Vivekji will add in his next edition.
Sir, definitely, sir. I will sell. These are all my own. It is not by from copied from anywhere.
No, that sir, passion sir. To learn, sir. That's why we want to be part of that passion.
Yeah. Sir. And some people are expert in making it. No, that day I told you, no, Modi's name. So some people are expert. It is very good.
They can make it anytime. Yes.
Yeah, you can. Sivananda sir can make a book of it.
Sir, whenever we will use your mnemonics, we will attribute to you 100%.
This is very important, sir, because student must know sight, sex, number, age, pain or painless. So that entire thing will give you entire picture of the bone tumor.
You can actually narrow down very fast. What are
that's true.
So in the exam, student will be confused whether it is what it is. Then this will give you. Once it is painful, you should think of whether it is infection or malignant.
And Gopal sir.
Sir.
I am lucky that when I was associate professor, Sivananda was assistant professor. We used to have a lot of lively discussion all the subjects, especially bone tumors and metabolic bone diseases. He's very good at this radiology, bone radiology, tumor radiology, and other developmental conditions. Once we seen one candidate appearance, what is that condition, Sivananda? One is seen one case, candidate appearance, okay. Pycnoid dysostosis, something like that.
Melioriosis.
Sir?
Yes.
Melioriosis.
Pycnoid dysostosis, something. Yes, sir.
Melioriosis, sir.
Candidate dripping disease.
I can share one case, sir, one x-ray, and
he picked up the diagnosis. He was my assistant when I was associate, sir.
I can share a small joke. When I was just a first year PG, so one of the profs, he picked up the x-ray and he said, what is it? So they were second years and some others. So he said, what is it? So he looked towards me and then I said, sir, it looks like melioriosis. Everybody looked at me because first years were not supposed to answer in government medical college. So he asked somebody else also who was an intern. He said, what is melioriosis? And that fellow said, sir, maybe the malaria of the bone.
it is like Laveria. Laveria just
wonderful.